doing a study of the book of 1 John that we are referring to as radical Christianity. And if you have been on vacation or been out some, you might want to look up our webpage and follow some of those studies on YouTube to get caught up. One of the things that we introduced 1 John with was the fact that he tells us the purposes for which he is writing. And we have actually covered already three of those purposes, and today he is going to mention a fourth purpose, which is do not be deceived, because you and I live in a time period when it is so easy to be deceived by the voices that are all around us. What is real Christianity? And he's raising a question for us: how can I know? How can I know that I am a Christian? That is a real question in our life today, not only of eternal significance, but it is a question for us because there are so many voices in our society who are telling us what it means to be a Christian. We need to get back to the basics of the Bible and ask the question, what does the Bible say a real Christian is? And there are some tests that John gives us for being able to determine whether or not we are Christians. A couple of Sundays ago, he raised this question, what does it mean to be a Christian? And he gave us a couple of tests to determine if we were. One of those is, how do I live? The Bible says that if we love Jesus, we're going to follow his commandments. So I am able to determine if I'm a Christian in one observable test by looking at how I live. Do I actually follow what Jesus said? The second observable test he gave us is, how do I love? How do I love? If God is love, then my life needs to begin to stack up with God's life if I'm now related with God, to God in Jesus Christ. So I can ask the question, how do I love? But there's more to being a follower of Jesus than how I live, the moral issue, and how I love. And that's what we're going to look at today. But before we do, I want to tell you a little story. As y'all know, I am an ardent Southerner and very much in love with history. So through the years, both my wife and my sons have gotten used to the fact that if we're driving through any Southern state, it doesn't matter where it is, we see one of those markers and it points to a battlefield. The car is headed to that battlefield. And we are going to walk that. I have drove my family and my kids from the time that they were just toddlers all over battlefields, all over the South. If you've ever gone through northern Georgia or Tennessee and Virginia, you know that Virginia has the most Civil War battlefields. Tennessee has the second highest number. So you can hardly drive down the road without seeing some battlefield where brave men in blue and gray gave their lives in a very formative time in the United States of America. Which you may not know, 620,000 men. 620,000 men in blue and gray died between 1861 and 1865 in what we know today as the American Civil War. When you think about the numbers that you hear reported, Jefferson Davis in the living room of the Burt Stark Mansion in Abbeville, South Carolina, met with his last council of war. And as he met with them, he stood before them and pleaded ardently with them to continue the war. His plans were to head into Texas, where there were some brigades that were still loyal, and from there, re-evolve and reinvent the South. He told them in that 4:30 afternoon meeting that their cause was just, that the right of the states trumped federal authority. He talked to them about the sacrifice that the South had paid from 1861 till that particular moment. The blood that was shed, the money that had been spent, the lives that were lost, lives that were forever changed. And he pleaded with these men to continue the war. He was the only one in the room for that particular point of view. To a man, his generals, his staff, told him that it did not matter if the cause was right. It did not matter if the cause was just. It did not matter how many had died, how many had paid the ultimate sacrifice, that the war was over. And it was time by a vote and for him to recognize that the Confederacy would be dissolved. And so that afternoon on May the 2nd in 1865, in the house in Abbeville, South Carolina, in the front living room, Jefferson Davis dissolved the Confederacy. In the early morning hours of the next day, he fled into Georgia, where he was eventually captured and placed into a federal penitentiary as a traitor against the United States of America. So we stood yesterday afternoon, my wife and I, in that living room where Jefferson Davis gave that passionate speech about the cause, where his generals had told him it didn't matter if it was right or not, that the war was over. And I thought about the message that I was going to bring to you this morning. Because the message that I have for you this morning is a little bit different than what took place in that front living room. Because what I'm going to tell you this morning is that not only is our cause right, but that our kingdom is eternal. And that if you are the last person on the planet that believes what is right, though the whole world be against you, you are to stand. That this particular sermon this morning is totally different than the politics of men. That this is about eternity. That this is not about what people may decide is right or what is wrong or what is worth fighting for or not worth fighting for. That this is about a kingdom that will never end. And that my eternity and your eternity are not based upon the votes of men and women, but about what our eternal God says. So the whole world may be against you, but it matters what you believe. Would you stand together and honor the reading of the Word of God? 1 John chapter 2, beginning in verse number 18 and reading, if you would, through verse 27. Children, it is beginning abides in you, then you too will abide in the Son and the Father. And this is the promise He has made to us, eternal life. I write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you. But the anointing that you receive from Him abides in you, and you have no need that anyone should teach you. But as His anointing teaches you about everything, and is true, and is no lie, just as it is taught you, abide in Him. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we have come here today not to discuss what people may think, kingdoms that people may try to create and tear down. We have come here today because we are serious about what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And we know it matters how we live. We know that it matters how we love. And we pray that your Holy Spirit, through the eternal word, will teach us today that it matters what we believe and what we think about Jesus. Father, we give you all the honor and all the glory and all the praise for what you are about to do in this place in our lives today. In Jesus' name we pray. It almost always boils down to Jesus up with the morality of Scripture if I'm a Christian. Already I can look at how Jesus loved, how God loves, and then how I'm supposed to love to determine if I'm a Christian. But understand, there is more to Christianity than morality. There is more to Christianity in how I treat people. Because at the very basis of the Christian faith is, what is it that I believe? And I believe if we're to get the complete picture that John is giving us, we don't divide these three things. How I live, how I love, and what I believe. Then we don't divide them, but we put them all together. What is important to know is this is in the age of the apostles, and they are already having difficulties within the body of believers from people who are calling themselves Christians, and yet they are teaching something different than what the apostles themselves taught. And what is it the apostles taught? What is it that is essential that I believe so that I possess eternal life? Well, we can start and say, as we do with the plan of salvation, I've got to believe I'm a sinner and need to be saved. But that's not his focus here. His focus is not so much on us as it is on God. I've got to believe, first of all, that Jesus actually lived as a man, that he died, that he rose again. Coupled with that, because he's going to talk about it later, I've got to believe that this same Jesus who lived 2,000 years ago, who died, who rose again, is coming again. So if I deny the second coming of Christ, if I deny that Jesus was actually a man, if I deny that he died for our sins, if I deny somehow or another that he actually physically rose again, then guess what? My Christianity is in question. I was at a funeral not so long ago, as one of the people who was seated in the audience, instead of preaching the funeral. I've got one to preach tomorrow afternoon. I'm sure the graveside's going to be worn with me in a jacket when I'm used to being in shorts and a t-shirt. But, you know, pray for me and pray for the family as I'm ministering to them tonight and tomorrow. But at this particular service, I was not the preacher. I was listening to the preacher. And of course, this preacher claimed to be a believer, claimed to be a follower of Christ. And so, like most preachers, I'm listening intently not only at the message and his outline and looking at his passage, but preachers critique other preachers. That's what we do. That's how we learn. That's how we make ourselves better. So I'm critiquing this guy as he's preaching his sermon. I'm following along with him pretty good. And then all of a sudden he starts talking about the resurrection of the dead. And so I'm very intent then, because this is one of the essentials of our faith. Jesus physically rose from the dead. Therefore, you and I are going to physically rise from the dead. That's an essential. We don't negotiate on that. Now, we understand that we're going to have a spiritual glorified body like his. We understand that our bodies are going to go through some kind of change. Because the Bible says that flesh and blood cannot enter into the kingdom of God. But we know that Jesus had a body of flesh and bone. He invited Thomas to touch his body. And yet it had been changed because he was able to appear in a room where the doors were all locked. So it's going to be different than what we have, and yet there's going to be some similarities with us. So I'm listening to this guy preach, and all of a sudden I'm catching things. This guy doesn't believe in the physical resurrection of the dead. Instead, what he's telling this crowd is that when you die, if you're a believer in Jesus, you get to go to heaven, and that's kind of the end revelation matters what I believe about God. Now, in this particular passage, you may just think that he's linking the Father and the Son, and that's what the church has often done anyway. But God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he mentions the Holy Spirit here because he talks about the anointing of the Holy One. So there's that assumption of this triune God, this one God, not three gods, this one God that we worship, who is always and has been and will be Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It matters not only what I think about Jesus, it matters what I think about God. So much so that John says, if I think the wrong thing about Jesus, I'm not saved. And if I think the wrong thing about God, I'm not saved. That's what he says. He says, and let's just boil it down to where we are. And we know there's more churches than us, but as far as church, we're talking about what we believe. That there are those who were with us who went out from us. Guess what? They never were us. Now, if I take all three observable tests and put them together, then I'm going to get this balanced picture. It matters what I believe. It matters how I live. And it matters how I love. So if I say that I'm within the family of faith, and all of a sudden I'm teaching something different than what Jesus is teaching, never was of Jesus. Because it matters how I live. If I'm a part of the family of the faith, and all of a sudden I am somehow or another rejecting the way Jesus loved in my life, and we know that I'm not perfect, so I can never love completely as he loved, but I'm supposed to be ever striving toward it. But if I reject the way Jesus loved, then I'm not a part of Jesus. Regardless of what I say. Or finally, if I don't agree with what the apostles said about Jesus and what the apostles said about God, I'm not part of Jesus. So here's this text. I run into people all the time. I wonder if I'm a Christian. I'm having doubts if I'm a Christian. Three little tests you can take. But don't just take one. You've got to take all three and put them together. What do you think about Jesus? What do you think about God? Did you get that right? If you got that right, then move on. How are you living? Are you living for Jesus or not? I'm not asking if you're perfect, because only Jesus was perfect. Because if somebody can be perfect, then we don't need Jesus. I'm not asking you if you sin sometimes. I'm asking, if I look at the totality of your life, how is it that you're living? Are you trying to bring your life into conformity with the life of Jesus Christ, or are you doing your own thing? Are you self-centered or God-centered? And finally, how do you love? Do you reject some people out of hand because of their social status or their educational status or where they're from or what they talk like or what they smell like or what they look like? Simple tests. I can't take them for you. You've got to take them for yourself. But this morning, I have no doubt that as you're sitting there listening to me, you're running through your mind taking the test. What I think about Jesus, what I think about God, how am I living, and how am I loving. So here's the question. Did you pass the test? Because if you didn't, you need to. If you didn't, eternal life is not going to be yours. eternal life can be yours through Jesus Christ. But you got to think the right kind of things. You got to do the right kind of things. You got to love the right way. But it all begins with thinking the right things. Because you see, I'm not saved by my works. I'm not saved by whether or not I'm following the commandments of God. I'm not saved